Hello, Narnach here. Welcome back to Grim Dawn. We are picking up where we left off last time. One thing you might have noticed me not doing was assigning a devotion point. So I wanted to do that in between episodes, and I realized that there is no actual connecting bridge between the Obelisk of Menhir thing over here and Stoneform over there. And if you really, really, really squint your eyes, you can actually see that there's a very faint line going on the left side here. So the way to get to Stoneform from the start is to take the left way, and the right way is just 2 points that are nice to have, but they don't help you get to Stoneform any sooner. So instead I picked up the Obelisk of Menhir thing over here, give us a little bit more defensive ability. It stacks with the other thing we got over there. And then once we hit the East Marsh, we're gonna go there. So no stone form for us. We're gonna need 3 more points. So that's gonna be ultimate when we actually achieve it. The helmet we found last time, the Empowered Face Guard of Perdition. It was a drop-in upgrade over our old one. We lost a tiny little bit of damage per second. We went from 57 to just under 5600. But we gained resistances for that, we gained armor for that, and we potentially gained entrance to into a empowered set. So I think it is well worth it. I moved over the Sanctified Bone because they are reasonably rare, and the Vitality and Chaos Resistance is pretty useful to have. So our Pierce Resistance went up a little bit as a result, and we are now 34% overcapped on Poison and Acid Resistance, so we are now ultimate ready with that. That's pretty nice to have as well. And if we get cursed or something, being overcapped helps you deal with curses. And with that said, let's dive in and horribly murder a Loghorrean, or get horribly murdered in the process. Either way, there is going to be horrible murdering somewhere this episode. So we are 69 regular mobs here, 70, that at least means we are on level. Well, if you move in here and you see that even the regular mobs are level 75, then it might be time to just scratch your head a little bit and maybe just grind out a couple more other levels. But I think for now, we're doing just fine. So, just seeing if we can get to the Loghorrean. Gonna be a boss fight somewhere between here and there, if I remember correctly. So, some kind of upgraded void parasite that is gonna be blocking the way for us. Of course, we'll have to put some salt on that slug. And after that, Loghorrean o'clock. I'm very curious to see how the fight's gonna be on Elite. On Veteran, I remember not being overly impressed because we were just face tanking him. Elite, things are a little bit more dangerous, and we have actually had to apply some serious hit and run tactics in a couple of situations. So I honestly can't predict which way the fight is gonna go. I hope it's gonna be an exciting fight. I mean, if it's gonna be a snooze fest, that means we are still overtanked as hell. On the other hand, if we are overtanked as hell, that means we'll have a better chance in ultimate. So it really depends on how you look at it, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. But close and exciting fights are of course more interesting to watch. For your sake, I'm gonna hope it's gonna be a close and exciting fight. And for my sake, I'm hope we'll actually survive it. Well, actually for all of our sakes, I hope we'll survive it, of course. Yes, it's nice to have a series continue. Hello everybody. Doesn't really seem like a nice and cozy room to chill in. So what the heck were you doing? Just standing guard here? That must be boring. Also, you're not really doing a really good job of guarding. Ooh, a crumbling wall, you say. hidden spoils, you say? Oh, I approve. Oh, it was so hidden, the hat actually popped upstairs. And I'm not gonna bother grabbing it, because it's just yellow. Hello there, you are one of the guardian slugs. Bane Gal Galore, guardian of the gates. Yeah, you might be trying to... Ooh, this saps your strength and it inflicts vitality damage. It actually lowers your DPS. It's a terrifying presence. Is that a... Yeah, that's just... It's an aura or something. Bug be gone. In terms of damage output, it's really, really not all that impressive. So that is good. I seem to remember one of my very first characters that made it this far had a pretty difficult time dealing with this fella. Skill's not ready. On normal, veteran mode, that is. So I think I've come quite far since then. And of course, with a super tanky character, well, victory over a boss like this is just an inevitability. He simply doesn't have the spike damage to get me down from 12,000 life to zero. So far, this looks promising in terms of how the Loghorrean fight might go. Well, let's have a look. Oh, this is a dead-end room. Might as well just move forward and have a look over here. Ooh. You are a level 74 bruiser. Boom, 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 boom. So far, so good. And there we are. Good. So the other day I was watching the stored version of the Twitch stream that the developers did where they showed some of the necromancer skills. It's looking interesting. Also, yeah, we have want to go back. There's hidden spoils there. It's looking interesting. It's different from what I had expected it to be, or imagined it to be. It's definitely not a summoner that's similar to, let's say, the Diablo 2 summoner or the even the Path of Exile summoners. There's a lot less emphasis on permanent pets. It's more an emphasis on temporary pets, which is actually a bit of a common theme in Grim Dawn anyway. On the occultist, you get your raven and you get your Stormhound, you get your Hellhound. As the Shaman, you get your Briarthorn monstrosity. That skill's not written. And those are the only permanent pets that you really have. The Occultist also has a higher level one, I think. I never actually had an Occultist high enough to get that one. Well, so for the Necromancer, the base skill is just gonna summon you three skeletons that live for 20 seconds. And you have a maximum of 5 by default. If you keep leveling it and add all the passives and things on top, then eventually you're gonna get a maximum of 9 minions that will live for 35 seconds each. And the casting cooldown is gonna be down to 10 seconds. So if you just keep chain casting it, then you can actually keep all of your minions up at the same time. This is of course just with the base skills. If you're sporting gear that can boost your maximum level, it goes up even further, I presume. And these skeletons are just a random mix of melee skeletons with just a sword, and they move a little bit faster. And crossbow archers or crossbow skeletons that move pretty darn sluggish. So it really is meant more as a combat augmentation rather than a permanent army of minions. There is the one of the ultimate skills, or at least all the way on the right hand side of the skill screen, is a Reap Spectre, Reap Spirit kind of thing that does a massive amount of damage to the foe. And then it effectively just rips out their spirit, and you get a 10 second minion, spirit minion that will just haunt enemies a little bit. No, do some damage, and it actually teleports around a little bit, so that's kind of neat. No, the whole idea of that ghosts can move through walls, the teleportation is kind of cool. Crypt entrance. I think it used to be that the guardian dude was before this door. I wonder why they changed that. Or why am I misremembering it? So, well, of course, the necromancer is not done yet. Everything could change, and they didn't show all the skills just yet, just a couple of them. One of the things is a melee passive that, when upgraded, has a 25% chance when triggering on a default attacks. And that will perform an AoE attack that does vitality decay damage. So that's vitality damage over time. And it also terrifies foes with 100% chance to actually make that happen. So that's more of a get away from me kind of deal. No, that if the terrifying works reliably, I haven't really had a terrify built in this game, so I'm not quite sure if it's actually a good mechanic, or whether it is as useless as it is in Path of Exile.
I can't do that yet.
But if it actually is a reliable mechanic that also works against the tougher foes, then you can combine that with a focus on damage over time. If you add bleed, if you add poison, if you maybe add some elemental damage over time, depends a little bit on what you combo it with, then you could potentially be doing a half hybrid melee necromancer kind of thing that does a lot of damage over time, and it just hits stuff and it just scares them away, and then monsters will just die naturally. Also, I went off on a wrong end here. Ah, yeah, we have to walk around. There's a little bit of a chest here. Probably down there as well, because dead end, and dead ends usually get rewarded. Oh, actually, this is not a dead end, this is a passage. Then there's not going to be a reward. Simple as that. Oh, Simbir's Searing Ember. Not very rare, but still. And let's actually have a quick look. I had a little bit of a cheat sheet over here. Yeah, made some notes. I actually went through the video, just looking at all every time the dev had the skill screen open, and just cramming down some of the notes of what the modifiers was going to be and things like that. All the numbers are of course up for change, but well, it does give an indication of what they're thinking of and the elements that they're currently thinking of and all those kinds of things. Let's see, anything I haven't mentioned yet? Yes, we have Drain Essence, which, when fully upgraded, it's a channel that does, let's see, vitality damage, a little bit of vitality damage, but it does massive ether damage, and it leeches 40% of the damage. Maybe I shouldn't be glancing over at my cheat sheet while fighting bigger foes. That sounds like a recipe for disaster. So let's actually postpone that. You go dead, please. Excellent. Yeah, that leeches 40% of the attack damage as health. So Oh, the necromancer has a pretty good way of keeping itself alive. Then there is Bone Harvest, which is for the graphics looked a little bit like a leap slam from a Path of Exile. Like a cone attack, you just slam the ground and then just spikes of bone go out, and I saw enemies fly all over the place, so there is a bit of a knock-up effect going on there as well.
I can't do that yet.
And it did quite some damage. There's some piercing in there, there's some cold damage, there's vitality damage, it slows targets, and it also scales pretty darn well with main hand weapon damage. And there was an upgrade to make it do more damage, but then you could only use it with a two-hander, and it also reduced the range a little bit.
Can't do that yet.
That's just one of those one-point modifier things. And there was an upgrade for that one, that it would, every time you kill something, it had a chance of, I think it was resetting minion summon times.
That skill's not ready.
Let's see. Oh no, actually it gives you a buff that just boosts all of your cold and vitality damage, as well as giving you a flat amount. So there's quite a lot of vitality damage and cold damage and ether damage are the three main damage types that we've seen so far on the Necromancer. So it seems like a rather nice bonus to just keep doing it. It's a sort of crowd control with the knock-up effect and the slowing. And if it boosts your damage, then of course other attacks are gonna be more potent. Yeah, well, then the cooldown reset is probably one of the upgrades for the summons. I think it was for the summons, yeah. Yeah, and there's a passive effect that boosts your maximum life by a little bit. That's also interesting. Just a flat amount, the amount listed for a level 100 character with a max level skill was 700 life. So, well, if you put it in perspective with having over 10,000 life, then of course it's not a terrible amount, but keep in mind that it's flat life. So it does get scaled by all the bonuses that you apply to boosting your life. So if you have, say, 50% bonus to your max life, as a percentage bonus that is, then that 700 will of course translate, get that 50% bonus as well, effectively making it 1050. So it is potentially interesting, especially, it also boosts your damage. It gives you some ether damage and gives you a percentage bonus to ether damage, and it boosts your max life. There's a lot of interesting things there. I was expecting more permanent minions, to be honest. That's not it, but on the other hand, it does make it more of a unique thing. And it is more of a Grim Dawn thing in that regard, because every class has to be able to do both melee and ranged. Even if you're a ranged character, you really often find yourself in melee range anyway. And the Necromancer, something that you would initially assume to be a pretty strict spellcaster, actually has a fair bit of melee support. So that's cool. I'm keen to try it. For now though, we are standing at the gate of the Loghorrean. Bloodlord Talonis is standing in front of it. Doing a Gandalf, saying you will not pass. And of course, we're gonna completely ignore him. He does do a fair bit of damage. He is not mucking with my resists, that's okay.
I can't do that yet.
Still, they are doing quite some damage. What is that debuff you are putting on me? Burning. Yeah, that's because you swapped some things around, isn't it? Spectral Miasma. Subs your defenses. Yeah, see?
That skill's not ready.
But yeah, it's blood damage, we're resisting that. It's fire damage, we are resisting that. So from that perspective, we're doing pretty darn good. It's just, I do get a little uneasy when I see my health bar move too much. And I'm definitely seeing it move too much here.
I can't do that yet.
Got a Dreadguard getting summoned in, okay. They're even more vicious than the other things that were summoned previously. Okay, it is down. Well, in the process though, we are getting the Bloodlord to slowly drop that. Okay, add-ons are gone. Bloodlord is nearly gone. You keep throwing the blood at me, but
that skill's not
pretty
ready.
Pretty not impressed by the blood itself. It's the other stuff that seems to be hurting a little bit more. Okay, let's just overguard here. Void Leech, sure. And then the boss is dead. We get Kalidor's shard and a seal of binding and some various assorted other things. Kalidor's shard is a, gonna say, an arcanist amulet. And indeed, it's an arcanist. It gets you +1 to arcanist skills if you get all 4 pieces of the set. But for now, we have arrived at the home of the Lord of Tentacles, the Loghorrean himself. So, final check. We have a Chaos Resistance Potion, we have a Ether Resistance Potion. Of course, this being a Loghorrean, it's probably not going to be ether damage, it's going to be chaos damage. So if you're taking a lot of damage, I might actually pop one of these blood-bound ointments. But for now, we'll see. Let's do this. Let's fight ourselves an elite end boss. Level 72, Loghorrean, Voice of Caton. Okay. Let's overguard here, just to get our regen up. Okay, so already it does feel like we are taking more damage than we were on normal. So I'm gonna see if we can focus at least on getting these tentacles out of the way. Just to reduce the amount of additional damage we are taking. And then we just keep focusing onwards. Oh, there's more tentacles again.
That skill's not ready.
Okay, that's one down. Let's go for the other. Okay, gone. Next. Yeah, he keeps resummoning that. That's the biggest problem. He keeps resummoning those tentacles, so maybe we should simply ignore them. Oop. Maybe my mouse shouldn't be going off by itself. Oh no, he ate Ulgrim and he summoned 2 heroics. Yeah, you know what? I think we're gonna be eating or killing those. I'm not eating things, I'm killing heroics here.
I can't do that yet.
Just get out of the way. Also, maybe I should get out of that portal thing that was appearing around my feet here. You never know where it sucks you. I mean, Ogham disappeared. Okay. Currently taking a lot of damage here. Let's also keep Overguard up. And once we've dealt with this
I can't do that.
Addition of heroes, we will go back and fighting the big monster itself. Okay, we got multiple arms on the floor now. That's also not good. So let's see if we can do a bit of damage control. for a little bit of cleanup. That might be a better way to put it. Yeah, because he just keeps barfing out those vanguards. These are the non-heroic versions. So let's see if this is doable. We always have a health flask to fall back on. I said as my health dangerously spike low. Whoa, overguard. Jeez. What the heck is happening here? Loghorrean, I know you don't want to die, but though, could you maybe try to be not as rude and dangerous, painful?
That skill's not ready.
He hurts. Well, I mentioned it before. I was hoping for a good fight, and I think we are getting a good fight here. This is definitely not a one-sided show. I'm slowly making progress in the winning department. On the other hand, the Loghorrean has a very, very good chance of defeating me in this fight as well. Dude. Okay. Menhir's will actually kicked in there. This is gonna be a slow and steady kind of fight. Okay, that's Overguard. Okay, if he embraces itself for barfing all that poison out, that might be a good opportunity to just run around a little bit. My usual strategy for most things is to just get in their face and tank. But a boss that can do this much damage, that's really not a good strategy. Eventually it will catch up with you if you are not capable of tanking it, so let's pay attention to boss mechanics, because, well, we have plenty of time to observe them anyway.
I can't do that yet.
So those chaos bolts we can deal with. The poison is painful. That's the interesting bit. It's the poison that's painful. Okay, actually used a flask there to just regain some life. Okay, if you're at a distance, he just does the... let's not do that. The moment he lights up a little greenish, that's your cue to get out of his face. Because then he'll barf all over you if you don't. Okay, I think we're getting a little bit of a rhythm down here. Okay, get out. Slowly, the add-ons just murder themselves. Ugh. I misplayed something there, because that was a lot of damage coming in. Barf. And back in for more. It's a bit difficult to gauge what exactly that big red shout is. In game, you don't really get a lot of feedback of the exact nature of that effect. And then we charge it again.
That skill's not ready.
Oop. It's the... No, there's a lot of layering of attacks and things going on here. The minions do provide a consistent amount of background DPS that it is being absorbed by our regeneration, but of course it, to a certain degree, it nullifies our regeneration as well. It lowers our effective regeneration, so we are spiking a lot more for our health and it takes us longer to recover from attacks that do go on. Let's actually trigger an Overguard then for a change. It's been a while. Also, there is a Tyrant in there. They hurt. Yep. Okay. Getting surrounded by multiple melee foes as well as multiple tentacles in front of the Loghorrean. Maybe not the brightest of ideas. And again, I don't always have bright ideas. Sometimes my ideas are slightly less bright. We get multiples of these chaos swirly thingamajigs going on, as well as multiple add-ons. Yeah, definitely noticed that we're in the final stages of the fight because it is getting tougher. Now, early on, we just got a couple of the couple of add-ons, and now things are really just stacking in a rather gnarly way. Let's get everybody's attention, please. See if we can clean up a little bit. I mean, if we stay out of his face, then things are relatively manageable. I said, okay, well, yeah, we're effectively this final stage. We're not really gonna fight without minions. That's just gonna be the conclusion here. Overguard up, and then we get out again. But yeah, our life bit just keeps bouncing in a rather aggressive, dangerous fashion. There should be an upper limit to how many minions will spawn, so that was a Menhir's Will that triggered again. Yeah, we simply lack the killing speed to deal with large groups of enemies, large groups of rare enemies, that is, that are a couple levels above us in a timely fashion, faster than the Loghorrean can respawn them. So for now, I think we'll have to accept that we are gonna have to tank this. Happens to be that this is a tanking build, so part of the plan, of course, is to actually be able to tank things. So far, so good. But yeah. Okay, everybody's down there. Let's move up here. Let's overguard and then run again because life is low. Let's just trigger a flask here. I mean, for a long time I really haven't had to use flasks unless I was in a real panic situation, and I think in this single fight I've used more flasks now in total than I've used in the rest of Elite. So this is definitely a step up in terms of difficulty compared to anything we've done previously in Elite. So no tip to you at home, this is a true fight. Be wary. So, getting out again. Okay. Okay, we are low on minion counts right now. Let's see if we can hit the Loghorrean in his face a couple times before things get gnarly again. Oh, okay. Let's call this gnarly o'clock again. And get out. Okay. Charge in, overguard. Punch. And get out. Trying to see if we can avoid fighting in the middle of those rifts. And then we charge in again for another bout with the Loghorrean, and we get out again the moment our life starts moving. Duck and weave and run. He's barfing. That's not. See, put Overguard up. Okay, shouting. And barf. Oh, mobility is of course part of that was a little closer than I would have liked it to be. Mobility is one of our advantages, I was gonna say. So definitely something to keep using here. You are nearly dead, that's good. Also, stop rifting me. Really. Okay, they... not all following me. But we are getting close, so... I have to be patient for the final bit. I do have the habit of when we're getting closer that I'm gonna take more risks, that I play more aggressively just because I want to get that kill. This is definitely not one of those fights where you want to give in to those instincts or compulsions. This guy hurts like a truck. And no, just ignore his life bar. Just keep going in and getting out. Going in and getting out. And at some point, the fight is going to stop. And that's when you can rest easy, but just ignore the health bar. Okay, and we can go out again. Nope. And back in again. Blitz actually does quite some damage. And I think we killed him. So let's mop up. We may now access ultimate difficulty. It's been a long journey, but we made it. Also, stop poking at me. You died. As you realize, you died. Look at there. You died. Yes. Thank you. Let's loot. Let's see. What did we get? We got empowered nether crown, which is an arcanist thing. +1 to arcanist skills. That's pretty darn cool. Next up. Something off screen. We got Wrathmorn. Two-handed sword. Reckless power. Kalidor's Tempest. That's not a item that's native to us. Portal. And another trove. I think on... normal or veteran, you get a legendary from the embassy in town. So let's see if we get that here as well. But after a very long fight, we managed to defeat the Loghorrean. So I'm very happy with that. My palms are still sweaty from the fight. It was intense. This was definitely a fun fight, and I'm rather dreading doing it with a character that doesn't have this life pool, because we got low on plenty of occasions.
Is it finished then? And so, our great moment of triumph.
Ooh, we get a Hammerfall Girdle, a legendary belt. I think this might actually be perfect for us. +3 to Overguard. Yes, please. +3 to Blast Shield. Yes, please. +7 to maximum bleeding resistance. We already had another belt lined up that had +6. This is +7. Pierce resist, bleed resist, reduction in bleed duration. Armor gets increased, armor absorption gets increased. And we have a 20% chance on block to trigger retribution. Triggers 2 second recharge, 3.5 meter radius. 20% main hand damage as well as a boatload of physical damage. Generates additional threat and it slows targets for 3 seconds. That's pretty darn cool. So we now have a legendary belt. Slowly but certainly we are upgrading most of our gear to be legendary, which is pretty cool. Our armor absorption went up to 85%, which is quite substantial. We didn't have anything, so it was at 75 before, I think. Let's actually quickly hover. What was it before? 74. So the more armor absorption you have, the more the entire armor rating is used to reduce incoming damage. Otherwise, you can only reduce damage up to a percentage equal to the armor absorption. So more is better. Our bleeding resistance is a lot lower. Yeah, because we were relying on 56% bleed resistance from our old belt. We no longer have that. Also, I think we lost more DPS again. Yeah, 55.8 becomes 52. That's painful. So we lost 300 DPS. But we gained good shielding. Overguard benefits from boosting it. It will absorb more, it will block more, it regenerates more, so it's just stronger all around. And blast shield, of course, generates a larger absorption shield. So, and after level 12, the extra levels, you get the most points out of it. So once this one is maxed, every point over the max is going to be way more efficient. So that's pretty darn cool. I have to put the poison resistance back in, but we are already overcapped on that. So might want to have a look at something that fixes up bleeding resistance, maybe a silk swatch or something along those lines. But we made it. We conquered Elite. We still have the technicalities of going into the East Mars, doing the hidden path and things like that. But for now, we have completed Ultimate. And with that, I'm gonna thank you very much for watching. And I hope to see you again next time. Bye bye.